And I think we're live. So welcome everybody to the seminar on 4 and 8K music, size-restricted music in general. The seminar will be followed by a two-hour workshop where you actually get to try some of the things I talk about here. For that workshop, we'll be joined by Gopher and Blueberry. They're already here. They're the guys that created the synthesizers that I'm going to talk about during this seminar. Also, I'll try something new. It'll go either way. Either it's going to be fantastic or it's going to end in total chaos. I'll be trying to allow questions during... So if you're a bit shy, don't want to hold a microphone for asking a question, you can actually go to this URL and type in a question. And then I get to decide if the question is good. I'll bring it to the slide, and I'll answer the question. This actually also allowed, if people are awake and watching the stream, they will actually be able to ask questions as well. I'll leave this on for now, and if it turns into complete chaos, I'll shut down the questions part, and we'll do it the normal way in the ending. Should anyone have any questions during my talk here, feel free to just raise a hand. With the lights dimmed, I can almost see everyone. So I think we're ready to start. We need a who's that guy? I found a very nice picture of me, perhaps from some revision party other year. My name's Casper, or Punqtured. I've been doing size-restricted music since approximately 2008. And I do it for groups called Fnook, Minimal, Danish Underpants Brigade, and I guest appear on various productions every now and then. I joined the scene in 92, then had a 10-year break from 2000 to 2008. Well, makes an 8-year break. And then returned and did size-restricted music. So, what is a demoscene soft synth, actually? It consists of three different parts. You have the synthesizer core, which is fed MIDI data or song data. It then generates audio, feeds it to the sound card, basically. Then you have the replayer. It's the one, the thing feeding the synthesizer core with the data. And then there's a UI. And today, the UIs we're going to talk about and going to show are VST instruments. It's really, really a good thing because it makes it easy for musicians to compose music using these synthesizers. Otherwise, we'd have to be able to program. So basically, the VST instruments is the reason I'm able to do this talk. If we needed to code the music, then I wouldn't be having this seminar, that's for sure. So, how does it all fit together? See, you have the synthesizer core here at the top. It's the same that's being used both in the intro, where you have some replayer code that feeds the song data into the synthesizer core, and the synthesizer core then creates the audio. And this is what you work with, that is, if you're a musician. You do instruments in your favorite music program or DAW. It then uses the VST instruments, which then feeds the signals, the MIDI data, into the synthesizer core, which generates sound, just the way all other VST instruments does it. But we need to get from here and to here. From the song you compose in your music program and into some kind of file format that can be read by the replayer and fed further on to the synthesizer core. Luckily, that's not the musician's headache, that's the coder's headache. So there's a different kind of approaches to do that, and I'll be talking about those later on. So the synthesizers that you may be able to use. there's a variety of synthesizers out there. Lately, and also for the second stage boss 4K intro, people are starting doing music for their 4K intros using GLSL. That's not exactly the scope of this seminar, because it requires the musician to be able to program or at least do some scripting of some sort. My focus is to allow people to get started with this this niche in music production, and starting with GLSL code wouldn't be my advice. So I know there's a variety of synthesizers out there, but I'll be focusing on three that makes it really, really easy. It's Fourclang by Gopher, and it's Klingster by Blueberry, and it's the new Oidos synthesizer. So what can I say about these synthesizers? They all come as VST plugins. They have nice examples. Instruments comes with it. According to what I've heard, they're pretty easy to integrate into your 4K framework. So these are the three synthesizers, and I added the year they were first used and the year they were released. So you can say that it took Gopher 2 years to release his synthesizer, while Blueberry then spent 5 years. During that time, he actually created two or three Amiga 4K synthesizers, so he may be excused on that. And actually, the Klingster had 5 versions before it was released. And then there's this new Oidos synthesizer. Some of you might have noticed, but it's relatively new. It was released last Saturday or last weekend. It was designed mainly to do the music for the last year's 8K entry called Nexus 8. I'll then talk about which DAW can I use, which music program can I use. There's a difference between how the synthesizers work. Fourclang records data. It means it's completely disconnected from whatever music program you use. Of course, it has to support VST players. Klingster needs song data to be extracted. It reads from the compressed XML format that Renoise Tracker uses. Actually, the XRNS files by Renoise, they're actually just zipped files. If you rename the extension to .zip, you can unzip it, and you'll get a nice XML document describing all the MIDI data that has to be fed into to the replayer. So Klingster works that way. It takes the file, unzips it, reads the XML, does Blueberry's magic to it, and then stores it as an assembly file. And Oidos works the same way. So that means right now you can only use Klingster and Oidos if you're using Renoise to compose your music. If you're interested in writing an exporter or integrating the synthesizer for another music program, you can always talk to Blueberry during the workshop after this seminar. It shouldn't be all that difficult. It's reading song data and posting it in another format, basically. So, which synthesizer should you choose then? Well, I tried listing the synthesizers. It's really, really difficult to compare the three of them. They all have different strengths and weaknesses. And I think one of the main things to consider at first is the ease of use. If you're used to doing working with synthesizers, particularly very old synthesizers, analog synthesizers, then you might find that Fourclang is relatively easy and it's pretty straightforward. If you're not used to that, you might find it's a bit tricky to get under the skin of, to get to really know it. Klingster and Oidos, on the other hand, provides an easy to start, a couple of sliders. I'll show you the synthesizers later on. A couple of sliders, you can just drag and pull the sliders and you get sound. It makes it easy, but it's also a bit harder. If you know what kind of sound you want to achieve, it's relatively hard using the Klingster and Oidos approach. It's relatively easy with Fourclang if you know what you're doing. funnily enough, these three synthesizers all represent different approaches to music synthesis. It's subtractive frequency modulation and additive synthesis. It comes across when you hear how they sound. You can actually tell that the way they generate sound is slightly different. I have three examples here. Thanks to Virgil and Sunspire, I was allowed to use respectively their Forklang and their Klingster modules. And the first is the song by Virgil from the intro called Rhodium, which also was nominated for the Meteorics Award. I'll just run you through a 1 minute clip of each of these synthesizers, and instead of just listening to how the melodies are and stuff like that, try to hear the characteristics of the synthesizers. And I hope this works. Let's see. Oh, I need to hit. The peak of what's been made already. I'm sure it's possible to do even greater things, but in my subjective opinion, it's one of the best tracks ever made for 4K so far. You need to consider also the bottom parameter called polyphonic. How many notes can you play at a time with an instrument? For Forklang specifically, you can play one note at a time with an instrument. It means you can't create chords. However, there's an 8K version where you have two Forklang synthesizers combined that allows you to do some more interesting stuff on that. For Klingster and Oilers, you do have polyphonic. You're able to play chords and stuff like that, which makes them better at strings and pads and choir sounds as well. Whereas Forklang definitely has the lead on bass and lead instruments. So let's go on to to Sunspire's example. It's from the intro called Blue Morpho. It's funny, I need to point down here. Has great strings, but it struggles a bit with the drums in particular. It's really difficult to create realistic drums with frequency modulation, but actually I believe Sunspire did an excellent job using this Klingster synthesizer. The final one is the new boy in town, Oidos by Blueberry, and since it was released only last Saturday, it's basically only my music I had to choose from. So this is from the Nexus 8 intro last year. You can easily tell that definitely the hi-hats and the clap sounds are a bit better with Oidos than with Klingster. It is possible with four-clang as well to do quite good drums. The real problem is always creating a plausible snare drum. But these are the three synthesizers. They all have very different characteristics. And that's basically what you should base your choice upon. Another thing that people talk a lot about is the footprint. How much size do these synthesizers consume? So I asked Gopher and Blueberry to create a song with one note, one instrument, the most basic they could achieve, and then hand optimize and see what size do you end up at. And it's really funny because all three of the synthesizers, they only vary by about 20 bytes. It's for four-clang, it's around 620 bytes. For Klingster, it's 590 bytes. But song sizes tend to get bigger with Klingster than it does with four-clang. So unless you want a one-note, one-instrument song for your 4K, then it might end up being a little bigger. And Oidos clocks in at 600 bytes, so, well, 30 bytes is what separates these, which actually leads me to the conclusion that size shouldn't be in your, it shouldn't be a matter of which synthesizer you want to choose. It's really impossible to get down to this size. Usually you'll end up somewhere around 900 to 1400 bytes, depending on complexity, number of instruments, so on and so forth.
Uncompressed data.
Compressed data. Okay. But it really isn't all that important, because since they all, it's within a 30 byte range, so it doesn't really matter if you choose one over another. It shouldn't be that that makes your choice. So, let's say you all decided on a synthesizer to use, then you need to work with instruments. You really need to experiment with the three different synthesizers. Try them out, all three of them. They're publicly available, so download them, try them out, get a feel for how they work, and see which one you like the best. All three synthesizers come with libraries, examples, instruments, stuff like that. So it's relatively easy. You download it and you're ready to go. Also, the included instruments, they're great for inspiration. If you use them, you'll probably receive a shitstorm on Poet if you just, oh, do your own instruments, people will say. I won't. I think it's actually great that people actually uses the instruments, you might just want to tweak it a little bit so people won't recognize them. Just turn one knob a little and or change one value and you're home safe. So, working with instruments. First thing you need to make sure of, they need to fit together. If you have 8 instruments that sound perfect in isolation, they might not fit at all. You really want to cover the low frequencies, the mid frequencies, the higher frequencies. This is not particularly for size-restricted music. This applies to all kind of music production, basically. So consider this as much as possible. It is rather difficult with these synthesizers, since you don't have all the tools, you don't have equalizers and compressing, side-chaining, stuff like that. You only have the synthesizers. So also, when you choose a music program, you can't use any of all the nice features it has. You enter notes, and that's it. And you shouldn't go for perfect either. Creating a perfect snare might be really good, but it's often not needed. You can cheat the listener's brain. If you create something that people would recognize as this is the time that you usually put a snare, then people will automatically think, oh, this is a snare sound, even though it sounds nothing at all like a snare. Or if you create piano instruments, play it like it's like a real person would play a piano. Don't play it like a 6-year-old will play a piano with one finger. If you enter the notes in a way that you would actually play a piano, if you could play the piano, then it will cheat the listener's brain. They will immediately think, oh, that's a piano. I still have this wet dream to create a banjo, a realistic banjo. It's really difficult. And it has this extra bright string on top. So study how the instruments are actually played. Go to YouTube, find videos of dueling banjos and stuff like that to learn how the instruments are actually played. That way you'll achieve way better results than if you just enter notes finger by finger, so to speak. And fake it till you make it. Do what's not possible. One thing that isn't possible is tempo change. You can't change the tempo of the song in the middle of an intro. But there's ways to do that anyway. You can have, in Renoise, you can lengthen a pattern's length. Instead of 64 positions, you can have 68 positions, thereby allowing you to actually fake a slightly slower tempo. Try to do what's not possible. It's basically what the demo scene is about, I'm told. Have more instruments at the cost of one. This is really for when you need to keep the size down. You can spend you can use an instrument for more than one thing. A bass kick at a very low frequency might work as a bass sound at a higher frequency. So 3 octaves up and you have a bass instead. So you actually get 2 instruments at the cost of one. A hi-hat and a snare can often replace each other too. So it's about experimenting a lot, particularly with the high and low frequencies. So if everything works out, I'll demonstrate how I exploited the fact that people, most of the old geezers here anyway, knew how the Nexus 7 soundtrack was supposed to sound. So I created, let's see if we can get this over here. Oh, I can't, it seems. Mm-hmm. Ooh, we have sound now. So this is the snare sound. Or clap. It doesn't really sound like a clap. It's metallic, it's not that good really. But it actually, when played at the positions where the original clap sound was, it creates the effect that it's actually a clap. Oh, the hi-hat. It doesn't work well on its own, but together with the riff, it fits way better. So you're actually cheating the listener's brains. They know this is where the clap should go, this is how it should sound. I don't need to go for all perfect clap sounds here. Actually, the original had two different clap samples and a snare samples, and I had to reduce that to one instrument that played at different pitches and different velocities, could serve as three different instruments. So I got three instruments at the cost of one for that one. So, I'll just, since I can't get Renoise to run on the slides here, I'll just move on to the next part. What do they look like? And I actually need to get Renoise over here. It can be relatively easy. I can do it like this, no problem. I can just drag it over. And I'll start with this is 4-clang, version 3, not sure it's the latest. You should download, of course, the instruments and the libraries. I have a link collection at the end of the seminar. So I'll publish the slides, and you can go and visit the three different sites and download the latest versions of these VSTs. I'm not going into details on how each synthesizer works. Wayfinder of Farbrush created a one-hour seminar on how to work with this synthesizer. You really should go and watch that. I believe it was from The Gathering or something, can't remember. A one-hour tour of how you actually do instruments when you work with 4-clang. How it works is you have all these set of instructions down here, and you have each instruction has a couple of parameters that you can tweak. You can load instruments, you can save instruments, and this is actually something that that Klingster and Neuters doesn't have, which is also why they only work with Renoise right now. It depends on Renoise's internal instrument format, so you save them as Renoise instruments, where in 4-clang you can actually save a 4-clang instrument and you can import it into any music program that you like. So that's how, and it does require a bit of knowledge about how synthesis actually work. You can store, it's a stack-based approach, basically, where you have these arithmetic. Oh. Yeah. And then I need to know a little bit about how data works on a stack, how you push stuff on the stack, modify it, multiply it by another, modulate it by another, puppet, stuff like that. It may seem a bit confusing at first, but actually I believe Wayfinder managed to explain it rather clearly in an hour. So if you got an hour to spend, watch his seminar and you'll be home safe on how it works. So that was 4-clang. Let's take Klingster. That's how Klingster looks in Renoise. You see you have a lot of words and you just have sliders. You can see this changes the basic waveform of this. And you can modulate it by a square, and you can detune it, and you can modulation detune, and you can easily end up with sounds going pew, pew. Because you have a pitch control. So these are the type of sound you usually end up with at first. So, and it has a lot of parameters that you normally wouldn't see in synthesizers, but they all represent different ways of generating sound. So we almost have a, as for an action game. So you have all these parameters, you pull and drag the sliders, and you get sound. It's easy to experiment because the sliders are there. You don't need to know in advance what kind of operations do I need to modify the waveform to sound like this. You just drag and drop, and there's a bunch of nice example instruments that comes with Klingster as well. Oidos is pretty much the same as Klingster. Let's get it here. So basically the same, just different words. it's an additive synthesizer, so it creates a bunch of waveforms and adds them on top, and then you filter how it's going to sound. So you have all these parameters. You can drag, drop. Ooh. A nice choir sound. And you have filter sweeps. The low pass filter, or the low position of the low filter, the high filter. And there's a filter slope. Oh, it got renamed. Filter sweep for the low, filter sweep for the high. Doesn't work right now, because I need to... Yeah. Yeah. So, on both Klingster and Oidos, you have these parameters times two. You have a Q version of each parameter as well. This allows you to quantize your parameters. To the right, you can see the actual value, and if I start to quantize it, let's see, this one is 3 dB. I guess it's a bit small for those in the back. If I start to and it jumps to 12 dBs. So I believe I'm able to quantize until here. The higher you're able to quantize, the smaller the instruments get. So you really need to experiment, sometimes do a compromise between size and quality. And always remember that people actually didn't hear the way it was supposed to sound. They only hear it for the first time in the finished production. So even though you know by yourself that my snare sounded better before I quantized the parameters, then people don't, because they haven't heard how it was before you quantized. So they won't miss stuff they didn't know was there. If you want to know more about how to actually work with instruments, Bero of Fabrausch is hosting another seminar tomorrow where he will dive into how to actually modulate instruments. You should go and watch that seminar if you're interested in knowing how that actually works. So, another very, very important thing is keeping the final size down. And how do we do that? We need to consider the fact that the song data and the synthesizer is compressed with the rest of the intro. You need complete control of all the notes. So if you choose to work with 4-Clang, and if you choose to use Cubase, Ableton Live, stuff like that, you need to consider the fact that for Cubase, for example, it represents velocity of a note by a color. So values spanning from 0 to 127 are represented by colors. And if you're able to spot the one note that has one velocity less than the rest by spotting a single little color difference, I think you're good. You want some you want to work in a DAW that actually allows you to see the values. So my recommendation would be to use Renoise or Saga Music's OpenMPT, also supports VST plugins. You need to really be able to see every little detail of every little note. Also, you need to consider the number of instruments that's possible. Yeah, talk to the coder. I know it can be terrifying speaking. You get answers that you don't understand all the time, but you need to know how much space can I actually consume when I do this music. That is, if the coder actually has an intro ready that you need to do music for. If he doesn't, then you're free to go. You spend 3.5 kilobytes and say, there you go. And he has 0.5 kilobyte to do his visuals. So that's you need to talk to the coder and consider how much space are you willing to spend on the music. Also, an important thing, consider if you need drums. Drums always comes in at least two, but most often three. You need a hi-hat, a snare, and a kick. Those can't usually replace each other. So if you decide to implement drums, that already adds three extra instruments that you need. So if you in any way can get away with creating a song without drums, you'll easily save three instruments just like that. You can do a single drum, a timpani instrument, something like that, and get away with it without drums. So, however, the song data of drums always packs perfectly because it's repetitive as hell and follows the same pattern. A hi-hat just goes tick-tick-tick-tick-tick-tick. It packs to almost nothing. And the same with the bass drum if you create a rather boring beat. But you still need to store the parameters for the instruments. So you should consider if you really need the drums. And then you need to hit this fine balance between when does things become really repetitive and boring to listen to, and how much bytes can I actually spend on the song data. It's really a difficult task to say you need to go this, you need to go that way, you need to at least have two melody lines, you need to have four melody. There's no actual answer to that, but you need to consider it when you talk to your coder and you agree on how much space you can actually use. Things tend to get a bit repetitive. You might get away with repetitive that are combined in different ways. So even though it's the same, let's say, chord progression, you have two chords that progresses the same way over and over again, you can have a melody that makes it sound different. And always start out too big, and then reduce size if you need to. And believe me, you will need to. Always. And you need to use Renoise or some other track-alike digital audio workstation. You need complete control of everything that goes on to be able to compress it. So, Ordnung muss sein. Patterns in data always compress as well. So create patterns. If you are able to spot a pattern, this repeats itself, I'm pretty sure that Klingster will be able to spot that, or Krinkler will be able to spot that as well. The best approach would be to know exactly how Krinkler works. It's just not. You need to study computer science for years, to have a doctor's degree in computer science. It's easier just to say, oh, this looks like a pattern. I'm pretty sure that Krinkler will spot that as a pattern as well and compress it. Four Clang stores note patterns and pattern indices for each channel. This is actually the stuff I didn't want to talk so much about because it gets kind of complicated rather fast. But these are the things that you need to be aware of. Which tone are you playing? At which velocity do you play it? And what's the note length? If you manage to use the same note length all the time with the same instruments, it packs better than if you have different note lengths. And of course, each of the above combinations, the more combinations you have, the more the size is required. So, this is what happens. It gets too large. You won't notice at first. You'll hand in the music to the coder and you'll see him start ticking at the eye, getting all pale and stuff. This is not what I expected. And you'll need to reduce the size of it. There's really a number of things you can do. First off, you need to see, can I reduce the number of instruments? Do I have a hi-hat that can replace a snare or the other way around? Can I somehow reduce the complexity of the song? If I have two different parts, can I somehow reuse parts of the first part to create a second part without actually having having a second part? Or if you're using Klingster or Eudos, it comes with a small converter tool. And yeah, this is somewhat tricky. It depends on how Crinkler actually works. Sometimes you can remove tones and the file gets bigger for no explanation. I'm sure there's an explanation down there somewhere in the code magic going on, but it doesn't always make sense. So you really need to trust that if you're able to spot a pattern in the data, then Crinkler will eventually be able to spot that pattern as well. It might not until you get to the very end and then create the final note, then it becomes so. Even if file size increases at your first edit, if you keep editing, it may drop to what your initial baseline was. So, these are the resources, but before that, I'll actually try to let you see that little tool we have. This is not that big. Everyone can hopefully see this. It's called Eudos Convert, and it takes a Renoise song as input. I created this test song. Oh. Caps locks there, and output it as music.asm. Oh, and I have an error in my input song. I knew that was going to happen. So what happens here is that this converter script actually tells me that the shaker instrument has a note somewhere that wasn't note off properly. So it will have infinite length, which causes your production to have a 10-minute pre-calc if you didn't correct this. So at least 10 minutes. So I'm just going to... Oh, it would be really cool if I could just have... I'll just see if I can... Oh, I can't. Well... Just a second. I'll just duplicate the screens then. So this is Renoise, and I have the two instruments. Rather boring, but it's a nice test track. And what the converter tool actually told me was that the track called Shaker, it's this one over here, in column 1, pattern 1, line 62, note not terminated. Insert off, it actually tells me what to do. So I go to the bottom, and yes, it's correct. I didn't note off that instrument. Usually, this will be, it's a basic hi-hat. And usually I'd have another pattern following this one where the note on the first position of the next pattern will automatically note off this one. But since this is the last pattern, I need to actually note that one off. So I created a note off, I'll save again. And let's see what happens now. Ooh, now we get some data. You have the tracks, the synth bass and the shaker. And I can tell here that velocities, I'm running full velocity. It doesn't cost me any bits. The length, however, I'm using a length of 1. I'm using that 11 times. The length of 2, I'm using that only 4 times. The length of 3, 2 times. The length of 4, 1 time. So what I actually want to do here is I need to see if I can reduce the different node lengths used. So if we go back to this and see, okay, we could just create node lengths of 1 for all of them. Oh, there's a delay on the beamer. So we'll just reduce it to node lengths of 1 all the way. Rather boring, but still people haven't heard what it used to sound like. So back to the tool, run the convert again, and now I can just see that the node length, I missed one somewhere. There's still one that has a node length of 2. Then, what? Line 20. Ooh, Gopher spotted it right away. Save it again. And this is actually how you do for hours and hours and hours and hours. You need to do this during your creation of the song. If you wait all the way till the end, it'll explode in your face. It'll be completely impossible to see where to start, basically. So now I'm now down to 17 instances of node length of 1. It also tells me which nodes I'm using, C2, C3, C4. Well, I'm using a relatively large amount of each. I'll just leave that here. For the hi-hat, the shaker, I have 2 different lengths as well. We'll just keep that. I can see here I have an F5 at a velocity of 40, where I also have velocities of 20 and of 80, full power. So I might want to find those that has a velocity of 40 and put them at either 20 or full velocity. So let's see if we can, it's over in there. Let's see, there's one. And this is what I meant about being able to spot all the little details. You wouldn't be able to do that as easily in Cubase or Live or any other non-tracker digital workstation. So, yeah, we need to save this and run the converter again. Ooh, it looks better and better now. And that's how you actually reduce. For the fun of it, we could see how... how the Nexus track actually sounds. Or looks like, not sounds. You just need to type music.asm. You don't need to know why. you just need to. You could type anything there, basically. So, this is the output from that. You can see this is what you would end up with if you did it at the very end of your composing. It's huge. It's really, really huge. And it'll take weeks to reduce the song size of that if you don't do it regularly. You can see the bass drum here. You now know that the Nexus 8 soundtrack consists of 447 bass kicks at the length of 1. And you have the organ. You could say that you might want to reduce. You only have 1 instance at the length of 9. I could have possibly saved a lot of bytes there by reducing or lengthening, but it just wouldn't be the same as the original. So that's the fine balance I need to do between size and staying true to the original. So that's pretty much what I had in store for you. No questions so far, as far as I can tell. So we should do it the old-fashioned way with a microphone, if anyone has any questions. And do note that after a short break, we'll have a 5-minute break, perhaps. I just need a cigarette. And then we'll turn this into a workshop area where you can actually bring your laptop. You can download the VST instruments. I'll be around. Gopher will be around. Blueberry will be around. And you can actually try some of the stuff. You can see how the converter tool works if you're using Plinkster or EIDOS. You can learn how to do the stack-based instruments with Forklang, and so on and so forth. So any questions before we turn this into a working area? Yes, we have a question.
Hi, thanks for the seminar.
Mm-hmm.
Regarding the limited polyphony of Forklang, what if you have many copies of the same instruments?
That would work.
They would compress well.
Yeah, they would compress well. And you can use, but you only have 16 instruments, I believe, in the Forklang version. So you'll run out rather quickly. But you could, of course, if you have a string instrument, you can have three different instances of the same instrument. And since the parameters for that particular instrument will be the same across all three instances, it would usually pack to zero, or close to zero. So you can create chords, but you need to do it and keep track of which instrument is playing which note at which time in the chord. Yeah, you can always get away with using two times polyphony. You can actually link the instruments, two instruments to one another. So if you change the parameters of one instrument, I believe, the other one changes too. So you can create chords that way as well. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Cool then. Well, thanks for listening.